This morning will break, and your bad thoughts will fade. As you rise and shake it off, and get on with your day. You'll hear a sad song, it'll sound sweet, it'll turn your mood around as you follow your feet. And you'll notice the beauty of the tears in the trees, in the laughter of children, in the jest of the breeze, in the cracks of the waves, in the sturdiness of stone, in the joy of good company, and in being alone. The darkness will loom, not far away. You'll find your comfort in an ordinary day. This morning will break, and so you will find you'll have caught up to those if I'd left you behind. 'Cause if you look closely at the thickness of wealth, you'll see the sorry side of dreams left upon the shelf. And it'll all come to be in the simplest of ways. It'll hit you so easily in an ordinary day. You'll notice the colors you thought you would never see. You'll find you're already someone you thought you would never be. And you'll let out the light you've kept locked away. When you notice the beauty of an ordinary day.
Welcome. Welcome to MacNeill Baptist Church. We are honored today to be the host site for this wonderful opportunity to honor the life of Ray Hobbs. We acknowledge that we meet today on the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee Anishinaabe peoples, and we pray that the future with the original people of this land is one of trust and friendship and respect. And I've been asked to offer a few pieces of information and recommendations so that our time together today is the best possible opportunity for honoring. First of all, the service will flow without introduction, so please follow along with your order of service. If you do not have an order of service, or can't see one to share, I'm sure one of our ushers will make sure that you get one. We are delighted to be able to sing today, although we do need to remain masked in order to do that, and I would like you to acknowledge that singing with masks on is a bit different than singing without a mask on, and should you feel uncomfortable at any time, please feel free to sit down. And in today's glorious weather, following the service, the Hobbs family will proceed out onto the front lawn of this church and would be delighted to greet you there, so please follow out into the beautiful sunshine. And now we begin.
Family and friends of Trevor Raymond Hobbs, we gather today on the first anniversary of Ray's death to remember and give thanks for his life. Our grief is a little less raw, and we have had this year to recall how much he meant to us. And so it is with celebration that we share our memories, knowing that the sharing will enrich our lives and deepen our relationships. Hear these words of scripture offering joy and hope, even as we stand in the presence of death. From Psalm 27, God is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? God is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And from Romans 8, Paul's letter to the churches at Rome. If God is for us, who is against us? Who shall separate us from the love of God in Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Our hymn is Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. I invite you to stand as you are able, and we can sing even with a mask.
Thank you. It is wonderful to see you here today. Family, neighbors, friends, former students, and colleagues. There were many who could not come because of distance and COVID or both, and greetings to you when we share this service through the wonders of technology. Ray was born on January 31, 1942, in Pontypridd, Wales, to Nancy Lloyd and Leonard Hobbs. There is a plaque in our kitchen titled, To Be Born Welsh. To be born Welsh is to be born privileged, not with a silver spoon in your mouth, but music in your blood and poetry in your soul. Ray had both poetry and music, but certainly was not born with a silver spoon. His first 4 years were spent in the home of his Lloyd grandparents with his mother and brother Michael, who was 2.5 years older. Mostly these were war years. Leonard spent most of the war seeing action in Europe and ending up as part of a bomb disposal squad in Germany with 2 Lloyd uncles also in the army. Uncle Trevor was declared missing, feared killed in Burma, so the new baby was named Trevor in his honor, and Raymond after the popular overture to Raymond. Leonard was a good violinist. Uncle Trevor actually survived and returned, but Father Leonard, although he survived, never returned to the family, and there followed a bitter separation and divorce. Ray's earliest memories were of spending nights in an air raid shelter at the bottom of the garden, the Victory Street party where he tried Gjeilo for the first time and hated it, and eating his first banana, skin and all, and starting primary school in Welsh. He recalled his maternal grandfather, a miner, who swore none of his boys would go down the coal mines, nor did they. And he remembers Grandfather Lloyd spending hours with his brother, Uncle Gug, up at the vegetable allotment to escape from the women of the house. Pontypridd was set in the Rhondda Valley in the middle of the Welsh coal mining district, fabled for its Welsh male voice choirs. The sound of choir practices and concerts resounding through the valleys, still to this day, avid Welsh rugby fans sing hymns in four-part harmony to cheer on their team. Those minor key Welsh hymn tunes were seared into Ray's soul.
Oh. In 1946, Dad's mother took her boys away from the familiar family home to England's south coast. She found work, but placed the brothers in a series of institutional foster homes for the next 6 years. Dad didn't speak much about those days, but he did tell me that he remembered it as a period of deep darkness. The post-war foster homes were hardly regulated. There was neglect and abuse, and what he described as utter loneliness. He and his brother attended regular school each day, returning to the foster homes in the evenings. They were devoid of warmth and caring, and I often wondered, especially when I had kids of my own, how a man brought up in such difficult, harsh environment would end up being such a wonderful, caring, and thoughtful father. In those dismal foster homes, Dad found his refuge in reading. He devoured books. When Dad was 10 years old, his mother came to the foster home with a man who introduced himself as their new father. A new household was formed and they moved to Devon. As it turned out, this new man was a charmer, a fast talker, an abuser, and a gambler, and a crook. There were frequent moves within town because the rent went unpaid and often not enough food for them. In Devon, Dad joined the Sea Scouts and developed his love of sailing. He made lots of friends. Children ran wild in those days, and he got up to all kinds of fun and mischief, which at least one time for Dad and his pals bordered on criminality. One of Dad's favorite stories involved a gang of boys who always hung around the harbor. To cut a long story short, Dad remembered it as the day we almost blew up the harbor. It involved firecrackers and a huge metal oil drum, a loud explosion, a shattered window, and all the perpetrators running home as smoke lingered over the harbor. Dad always succeeded academically, and at 11 years old, he passed the entrance exams to the all-boys King Edward VI Grammar School in Totnes, Devon, a school founded by that king in 1553. He did excellently, including 100% in physics. Unfortunately, he had to leave school at the age of 16 in order to support himself. He had been kicked out of the home by his stepfather. He found work in a cafeteria and a local library, and then full-time work as a conductor on the double-decker bus system in Devon. He made change and delivered tickets from the ticket machine strung around his neck. From the ages 16 to 19, though, in his downtime, he self-studied for advanced-level national examinations. He was a high school dropout, but he was determined to get into university.
As a teen, Ray connected with Upton Vale Baptist Church and became a Christian and was baptized at the age of 15. Throughout his teen years, he had two adult mentors who believed in him and encouraged him, Pete Pannell, his scoutmaster, and my father, John Lipscomb. He got involved with the Upton Vale gospel team led by my dad. This involved a group of mostly young people going out to all the little chapels dotted around the Devonshire countryside. Ray learned to lead worship services, read the scripture in public, and finally he preached his first sermon, telling the congregation everything I knew in 5 minutes, and then I sat down. He felt the call to ministry and applied to Spurgeon's College in London. Prior to acceptance, he was obliged to learn New Testament Greek, which he did by self-study. Ray and I spoke together about how resilience research was relevant to his own childhood experiences, in that his first 4 years were stable, spent within an extended family, albeit there was a war on and an absent father. He had a good brain, and he was a good-looking kid. Finally, as a teen, he connected with a supportive community, the church, and was encouraged by two adult mentors who believed in him. We met at our church, may I say, a prime place for meeting and dating in those days. We started dating when Ray was 21 and I was 17. When I say dating, we were both financially challenged students in London, so many of our dates involved lengthy walks in St. James's Park, winding up in the local Lion's Corner House for a mug of strong tea each and sharing a jam tart. We married when he was almost 25 and I was 21. We always mention that our church paid for our honeymoon, as they gave us £20 sterling as a wedding gift.
You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light as you. For you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book, before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I am awake, I am still with you.
Thank you.
After 4 years at Spurgeon's College, Ray graduated with a Bachelor's of Divinity from the University of London. During these years, he developed a passion for Old Testament studies and the driving urge to continue his studies. He headed off to Ruchlikon International Baptist Seminary in Switzerland, enrolling in the master's program and simultaneously in doctoral studies at the University of Zurich, which required attendance at courses in German. Ray didn't have any German, but seemed to learn it very quickly and somehow became fluent enough to provide simultaneous translation from German to English for services at the seminary chapel. We got married at Upton Vale Church on New Year's Eve 1966, after Ray's first semester at Ruchlikon. That aforementioned honeymoon, paid for by the church, took place in Switzerland. Our 2.5 years in Switzerland were an idyllic time. Our first apartment was downwind a factory, but it was the Lindt chocolate factory, and adjacent to a field with Swiss cows, complete with bells. We then moved on to campus into the married student apartment building, along with folks from all over the world. Now, coming from teetotaler British Baptist stock, we quickly got over our shock that German, Spanish, and Italian fellow students drank beer and wine and smoked. The Europeans, in turn, were shocked that American women, for example, Billy Graham's wife, painted their faces. We quickly came to understand that the differences were cultural and not related to faith, and we all had a wonderful time together studying theology and making friends and our own fun. We're talking 1966 to 1969, and the seminary was very progressive in that it provided its own daycare so that both parents could enroll as students and attend lectures. We even engaged in a one-day student strike. Ray gained his master's degree in 1968, but stayed on for his doctoral work. It was in the fall semester of 1968 that Dr. Jerry Harrop blew into the seminary, along with his wife Frieda and daughter Kathy. Jerry was on sabbatical from McMaster Divinity College, and he wound up teaching me Old Testament. When Jerry got back to Mac, he discovered that a junior position had opened up at the Divinity College, and he recommended that Ray be considered. And to cut a long story short, an invitation came. Ray got a job at that time without first deciding he wanted one. He was now halfway through the doctoral thesis and had gone through the process of switching from the University of Zurich to the University of London. I had just found out I was pregnant with Catherine. But hey, we were young and didn't have a good understanding of the Richter scale of stresses. We said yes immediately. The initial invitation was as lecturer for 1 year with option to continue if everything worked out. We said to one another, well, let's go for a year and maybe even stay three. The rest, as they say, is history, with Ray spending 25 years at the Divinity College. Our son Greg was born some 4 years after we came to Canada, and we came with 6-week-old baby, Catherine. The McMaster years, 69 to 95, I will never forget the warm welcome he and we together received from faculty and students alike, and how immediately we felt at home. It turned out that Ray was a born teacher. Mind you, at the beginning, he fought to keep half a lecture ahead of the students. A month into his first term, Ivan Morgan, the then principal of the Divinity College, approached Ray with a request that he consider serving as interim minister at the Baptist Church in Beamsville. It now seems quite crazy that he agreed and added to his workload 2 services and sermons each Sunday, and I think maybe a midweek Bible study as well. We piled our newborn into the Volkswagen Beetle and went off for the whole day each Sunday. Crazy maybe, but are we ever thankful? Because there we met 2 families, the Smiths and the Allens, who became like family to us too, and still are. Ray was cross-appointed to the McMaster University Faculty of Theology. He initiated several important projects which added to the life and work of the college. Notable was the development of a Holy Land element to the teaching of biblical studies, including developing a course which concluded with a guided tour of the Holy Land. The family was privileged to experience Ray's year-long sabbatical in the Holy Land at the Tantor Ecumenical Institute, located between Bethlehem and Jerusalem. The experience of living in the Holy Land itself and meeting other biblical scholars galvanized Ray's understanding of the biblical texts from a social context perspective. Thereafter, he became an active member of the Context Group, an international team of scholars that merges historical exegesis and the social sciences to interpret the Bible in its social and cultural context. In 1985, Ray and Catherine volunteered together on an archaeological dig at Tel Dor in Israel, following which Ray led groups of students in the McMaster Tel Dor project over a number of years. These groups included our great friend of blessed memory, Terry Woods. And over the years, Ray was always writing, producing numerous scholarly articles and two full books. Following retirement from McMaster, Ray was appointed Professor of Old Testament at the International Baptist Theological Seminary in Prague, the Czech Republic. Ray found it a privilege to mentor and encourage many excellent and dedicated students to support their critical thinking and encourage their dreams. Apart from his teaching, Ray really enjoyed his social contacts with students and staff, mainly from countries in Eastern Europe. They used to make their own fun with film evenings or movie going and occasional dances, with Ray willingly pressed into service as the resident DJ. I remember that Heard It on the Grapevine was a big favorite. Prague was a classical lover, music lover's dream, and he enjoyed many concerts in the land of Smetana and Dvorak. He quickly connected with the Na Topolce Baptist Church, learned a smattering of Czech, and made new lifelong Czech friends. After IBTS, he returned several times to the Czech Republic to co-create an academic conference along with ministers and former students and colleagues.
Heather has asked me, as an MDiv student of Ray's at McMaster, to tell about Ray, the professor of Hebrew and Old Testament studies. I shall bookend my memories. An early story about my first private encounter with Dr. Hobbs in my second week at Mac, actually in his role as department head. I didn't have Ray as a professor until my second year. And an end of degree program story from our class's graduation celebration, a dinner party up on Hamilton's mountain. Some personal stage setting for the first story. I came to Divinity School with a degree in physics and 2 years employment in telecommunications research. I knew how to study and perform that sort of stuff actually quite well. Old Testament 1A4 was taught in 1981 by Malcolm Horsnell. The course outline and requirements were covered during our first lecture on September the 15th, when the class learned the extensive reading list and that our first test would be in 3 weeks' time, 3 weeks, and for it we needed to read and know John Bright's A History of Israel. I recall feeling like someone had just told me to dive into a pool and figure out breathing underwater. I put up my hand and stumbled out some words like, "You mean we're supposed to learn dates and names and places and events for the whole history of Israel?" "That's correct." I went home and started reading that very night. My David C. Cook Sunday school days and a New Testament-leaning lifetime of sermons didn't prepare me for this. I had no filters to know what was of lesser importance, which meant it all seemed very important. I came back the next day, commiserated with multiple classmates, equally gobsmacked, obtained an appointment with department head, Dr. T. Raymond Hobbs, made complaint about these totally unreasonable expectations, especially in the midst of all the other coursework piled on, and was told, "You'd better stop wasting your time and get on with reading the book." Fast forward to the celebratory evening at the end of Div School. It had been arranged that our class would parade into the dining hall where our guests had assembled. Ray was the professor directing the procession. I cannot remember how in the world it came up, but somebody made some undoubtedly astute and appropriate reference to the year of Jubilee, whereupon Bond, in process of graduating with certain honors, I might add, opened my mouth and said, "What exactly is that?" Dr. T. Raymond Hobbs drew up short, looked at me with such disgust, and suggested that perhaps the degree should be taken back. Ray, if you didn't already know, was the Divinity College professor most feared. This was that good Old Testament kind of fear, fear of the holy, whose fundamental component was awe. Because how could any one brain hold so much information? Talking with Ray was like talking to the Mills Library. On the student side of the desk, the fear played out as recognized puniness. Handing in papers was like bringing an offering to the altar. You knew there was going to be burning, but you just hoped it might overall produce an odor that the god somehow found appeasing. And how important it is for a divinity school student and a divinity school to be challenged and held account in this way. Between those two bookends came for me such rich formation from Ray and a grand group of professors. To those who shared the student experience with me, remember Ray's Divinity School Resource Center on the history and land of Palestine. All those slides and artifacts. And how many of you here, just like my wife Lynn and I, got not just to study, but actually to travel that history and land with Ray, just for fun? How many did that here? Yeah. The overall effect was to ground our evolving knowledge and theology and ministry, our faith, in that first testament, which, after all, was what had produced Jesus. Ray, with his love of the language, the land, the history, the geography, the people and their society, the text, his hands dirty in the archaeology, his mind ever expanding with newest scholarship, his heart impassioned to share all of it, Ray stood guard as our teacher so that any and every unsupported claim or weak argument or distorted reasoning or unfounded conclusion, of which church history and current Christian life has far too much, it all got held up to the light, dissecting it and dismantling it so that the pieces could then be used to build something actually having integrity. Thank you, Ray, for scaring the hell out of us. It was just what we needed.
I'm just gonna go off script here and say, I remember when I was in university, I thought it would be a wise idea to have my dad proofread one of my essays that I did. It was 9 pages, and he read it and said, oh, that's good. That's a good introduction. Now you're going to get to some examples, right? And get to the point. Anyways, I didn't do that again. Dad formally retired in 1998, but being an academic, he spent much of his waking day in his home office, reading and writing and never tiring of this. For a few years, he returned to McMaster to teach a segment of one of Gary Purdy's engineering courses. The subject was ancient urbanization and social change. He recalled one of the evaluations of his part of the course when a student wrote, "Keep the old Welsh guy." Dad proceeded with work on a new book on warfare in the Old Testament, along the way following new insights into the subject, insights such as the depiction of combat stress injury in biblical and ancient poetry. Mum referred to this project as his magnum opus, and sadly it remains unfinished. He spent much time reflecting about various subjects and writing these up as short essays in what he called his musings, for example, God, language in the pulpit and worship, the nature of biblical translation, and the strong role of women in early Baptist history and leadership. He happily became part of the preaching team here at MacNeill. He always began preparing his sermons by what he called close reading of the scripture's text. For Dad, this meant consulting the original Hebrew and Greek texts, and often retranslating them. Books remained his joy. He loved poetry and biographies and books on history, sociology, anthropology, and spy novels. A major supporter of Westdale's local bookstore, Brian Prince and later King West Books. Dad once wrote that beyond human contact, there is nothing so sweet as opening a new world to be found in the pages of a book. You might think that all this reading and studying made for a dull retirement, but of course, Dad wouldn't agree. He indulged in his love of history, not only through reading, but through 1812 reenacting, opening a new world of friendship and exchange of knowledge. Early on in his reenacting days, when he was in his late 50s, Dad got so excited about his fully functioning replica musket that he loaded it with gunpowder and fired off a blank in the driveway at 35 Tromore. The blast echoed off the neighboring houses, numerous car alarms went off, and a bunch of neighborhood dogs started barking. Dad ran back into the house and right up into his office as a plume of smoke hung in the air. That boy who almost blew up the harbor, clearly still in there. He had a short-lived acting career, portraying a drunken, disgraced American general for a movie of the War of 1812. He also served as a member of the Regimental Senate for the Royal Highland Fusiliers, becoming involved in fundraising for sufferers of post-combat stress. Sorry, he always stressed to me that it wasn't post-combat stress disorder, it was post-combat stress. Mum's going to talk about his love of music, but I did want to mention that as he got older, he broadened his musical tastes. He even got into bluegrass and country music. He went with me to see Willie Nelson, Robert Plant, Bonnie Raitt, and others. And we shouldn't forget that he built a small sailboat in his basement and driveway. It's the only thing I remember him building. And I don't think any of us thought he'd finish it, but he did, and it worked. It was a blue boat with one red sail, and he enjoyed sailing it in Hamilton Bay. Throughout all this, MacNeill Baptist Church remained Dad's beloved community, a major source of friendship and support.
Thank you. I'm here representing what some might consider a very strange passion associated with Ray. Ray very much enjoyed traveling to faraway places where many like-minded people had also journeyed. This mob would choose an empty field or a park-like setting and then begin to set up a tent city where they would live for the weekend. They would further disrupt the setting by digging fire pits for their cooking, sing, shout, discharge firearms, and then after hours, socialize well into the morning hours. Thousands of people would come out to witness this strange spectacle. What I'm describing is historical reenacting, more specifically reenacting the World War of 1812. Some might call it a hobby. We feel it as a consuming passion. It is a truly unique and caring community. It is a place for people who love history to share that passion and to use it as a platform to interact with a much broader audience, to share the experience and teach them about an aspect of their history that is seldom reflected. I would like to thank Ray's family for giving me the opportunity to speak on behalf of some of Ray's closest friends here with me today, but also on behalf of this incredible community, which are the reenactors, but also staff and volunteers for a number of prominent historic sites in Canada, the US, and Cardiff, and quite a number of prominent War of 1812 experts and academics. Ray recruited me into the 41st Regiment reenacting group 20 years ago. The 41st was a British regiment in Canada during the War of 1812. The 41st is one of the antecedents to the Royal Welsh in the modern British Army. Ray had found his way into the 41st as he was doing family research and discovered a Hobbs served in Canada during the War of 1812 with the 41st. While in Cardiff doing research, Ray established relationships with the 41st or Welsh Regiment Museum and subsequently the Royal Welsh. These are connections which we maintain and cherish to this day. And it's because of these connections we've been honored to have been part of a royal dedication of a museum where Ray and I met Prince Charles. And then on further trips to Wales, which unfortunately due to his health, Ray could not join us, but was there in spirit. We were involved with ceremonies involving the Queen and then a celebration of the 300th anniversary of the founding of the 41st Regiment. Ray was the officer commanding the 41st Regiment for a considerable period of time. I had the honor to serve as his sergeant. Ray prided himself on being a tough, stern, and demanding officer, hardly characteristics that you would associate with the reenacting sweet-tempered Ray, although you showed me a whole different side of him. If the officer is the good cop, his sergeant is the bad cop. When Ray told me that because of his health, he had to step down from his command, he also told me he was going to leave the hobby so as to not interfere with my succession of him in the commanding role of the 41st. There was no way that we were going to allow him to leave a hobby that he enjoyed so much. Personally, I'm very honored that a man of Ray's stature would consider me a friend. We had some great adventures. There were special ones like a VIP tour of the Tower of London, including the ceremony of the keys, and also meeting royalty. But my favorites were staying with Ray at his uncle Bryn's home in Pontypridd and roaming the Welsh countryside. Many of you may have heard the story that Ray would tell about the Welsh gentleman who invented a chicken plucking machine that was a spectacular failure. I can assure you the man was real and truly was a character, as I had met him in the kitchen of Ray's cousin Rita's farmhouse. I still have memories of Ray excitedly grabbing my arm and whispering in my ear, "It's the chicken plucking man." So, you know. Ray encouraged my passion for history, helping me to research using primary sources and pushing me to write and speak on my research. He did this for so many other people. Ray loved people. He fanned the flames of their passions and really liked when that passion was for history. Ray was widely known in the hobby in Canada, the US, and even Europe. He was widely respected and loved. My fondest memories were seeing Ray and his buddy Terry traveling to events. They were a precious duo. I like the knowledge that Ray is with Terry again. There must also be a canvas tent where reenactors can gather, enjoy a beverage or two, and are probably lustily singing Monty Python's Philosopher's Song.
Ray and I were married for almost 54 years, mostly ensconced in the communities of Westdale and MacNeill. Ray loved being a dad and was so proud of his children. The years with small children flew by. There were hard and sad times with the loss of a child just before birth and facing surgeries with Greg. Ours was an interdependent relationship. We had some shared interests and some definitely not. We were mutually respectful of each one's need for solitude and separateness. Ray strongly encouraged me in my own career pursuits and supported my goals and plans. We enjoyed each other's company and conversation. We shared the household work, with Ray increasingly happy to take over the cooking and me increasingly happy to let him. He taught me how to cook the perfect boiled egg, and he made the best French fries, with the secret being in the double dipping. We loved to take day trips around the countryside and soak up the land and local history. We made and kept many good friends. Ray was a movie buff, more so than I. He knew all the names of all the British actors and their acting histories. Always there was music and singing, carol and hymn singing parties at number 35. Bring your own instrument if you have one. For a number of years, we sang together in the Hamilton's Bach Elgar Choir, one of the tenor alto couples, and thoroughly enjoyed singing the great classical choral works. Ray eventually switched from tenor to bass, but was always in tune. Church saw us both in the choir and for a number of years as half of the Purdy Hobbs Quartet. Ray loved all music and listened to all kinds every day while at his desk. The years passed quickly. Catherine and Greg grew up and left home. Along came son-in-law Craig and daughter-in-law Allie. Ray wholeheartedly welcomed them to the family. And in the fullness of time, he was absolutely thrilled to become a grandfather, papa, to four terrific granddaughters, two for each family. His cup was flowing over. Isabel, Linnea, Iris, and Lydia, papa loved each of you and treasured that you came into the world and into our family. He enjoyed watching you grow and learn and become your own special personalities and develop your own interests. Over his last years, Ray bore his declining health with grace and fortitude. For a man who had once fainted at the sight of a surgery portrayed on black and white TV, he grew very used to weekly blood transfusions and other treatments and was enormously grateful for the medical advances that he benefited from. He became a favorite of the hematology clinic nurses and developed friendships with other clinic patients, serving as an encourager and supporter to many. At the same time, he did not allow himself to be defined by his illness and lived to the fullest until the last few days in hospital. Catherine, Greg, and I were privileged to be able to say our meaningful goodbyes to him on his last day.
In 1980, just before Dad's sabbatical year in Israel, I was in grade 5. I can remember complaining at dinner that I had to do show and tell. Dad looked across the table at me and suggested I present something about the Camp David Accord. Middle East peace was a constant topic in our house that year for obvious reasons. So I went off to school armed with a clipping from the Globe and Mail. Here is Menachem Begin, the Israeli Prime Minister, shaking hands with Egyptian Prime Minister Anwar Sadat. There were a lot of weird stares from my class. Dad would have said it went down like a lead balloon. Afterwards, someone asked me why I was going to Israel for my birthday. But I can remember thinking that Dad was right. Keep your eye on what is important. Peace in the Middle East is really important. As many of you know, Dad had a wry humor, a developed sense of irony, and he enjoyed witnessing human comedy. Of course, he also had real glee connecting history to the physical world. During that sabbatical year, he took me on a personal tour of the remnants of the City of David in and around Jerusalem. He pointed out the walled over Golden Gate, where the Jews say the Messiah was supposed to walk through, Then we visited the stacked Jewish cemetery on the Mount of Olives on the other side, where the buried were waiting to see the Messiah arrive. He always framed it that history was shaped by those in power. I have memories of him telling us about the standoff with the Romans at Masada as Mom, Greg, and I walked down the fortress mountain on one impossibly hot day. And at another time, talking of the Maccabees' guerrilla warfare and how they dropped out of the trees to surprise the Romans who outnumbered them. These types of comments, of course, were regular on a Hobbs outing. Or of him standing by the narrow, silty River Jordan when we did our tour of the Sinai, all examples of Dad so easily connecting place with history. One day, Dad invited me to one of his lectures at Mac, which preceded his tour of the Holy Land. I think it was around 13 or 14. He was discussing the places the group would visit and showing those slides you heard about, of the slides of the landscape and talking about the history and the biblical texts that related to each of them. I was not surprised by the types of things he said or his intelligence, but I do remember thinking, wait a minute, he's really good at this. He was a natural teacher. Preparing to go on the dig the first time, Dad, of course, taught himself archaeology by reading a number of foundational texts. He invited me to join him in this curriculum, but I did not make it very far. I was only 16 at the time. Of course, when we arrived, he hit the ground running and was immediately at home discussing things with prominent archaeologists and cultural anthropologists from Israel and other countries around the world. Just there, that was him, his intellectual flexibility. I remember him in his tilly hat and an old dark blue salt-stained t-shirt. Graciously, he gave me the freedom to be myself among this troop of graduate students and scholars. I was not at all surprised that he swam so easily in those waters. This, after all, was who he was. And of course, he was not at all about the intellectual jousting and posturing that narrow academics seem to engage in. But he had a real love of knowledge, of following where it took you, of testing ideas for soundness, intellectual integrity, ranging interests that spidered out all over the place. In later years, he'd say things like, I'm researching First World War poetry, or I'm looking at the role of chaplains in the War of 1812. Of course you are, I remember thinking. When we had discussions, he was genuinely interested in sharing and not assuming. That was a gift. And his interest that justice and good judgment should not be plowed under. It is open for you to decide. For a girl child, this seems now very important. How you can go down ever-expanding veins of discovery if you are led by curiosity, ingenuity, and know how to find. An elegy, a thank you. The words I have from you have scattered, but they remain with me, speaking deep in my inner ear in your voice. Phalanx, epaulette, cuneiform, Hittite, Canaanite, Moabite, battalion, Judea, Aramaic, and some names, Herodotus, Josephus, David, all bound into your love of words, of knowledge of past things buried. It makes sense you were born in that war. And the scrap paper sitting in a neat pile under your printer, ancient Hebrew or Bible quotations and deft arguments, all in sure calligraphy. All that taught me that we are in a line from the ancient past to right now. Freeze. That human comedy, catastrophe, community, and war always run like a frieze behind us. Your bookshelf, your breadth of range. That causing suffering is wrong, suppression is wrong. To engage keenly with your mind, there's another word from you, keenly. Pleasure in knowing, pleasure sharing knowing, all of that now gone inside, suffused. I flow ahead in time, your face imprinted on my mind. Hearing you in my inner ear.
Before I try and sing this song, I just wanted to mention one lesson that my dad taught me, and it was, we were having a conversation, I think it was in my 30s, or early 30s, maybe 20s, about depression, and we were talking about, sometimes you just wake up and it feels like darkness and you don't want to get up out of bed, and he said, he related to that strongly, and he said when that happens to him, he said he would think of the little things. And we found this list in his office after he passed away, and it's called the List of 100, and it's just a list of, clearly a list of things to be thankful for, and it has Mom's name, it has our names of the family. It has number one on the list is music. And then he has like a glass of red wine, a clean shirt, and you know, fresh bed clothes, the smile of a child. And it's a beautiful list, and I now keep that in my office. And that's just another simple lesson Dad taught me.
I know, got to all cross over. River I've seen runs randy, rough and wild. There'll come a time the waves stop rolling. We're all gonna meet that day on the other side. Friends of mine, they cross before me. They're sitting warm now, my Holy Spirit's fire. The troubles are gone, you see, and their souls unbounded. They're singing joyfully in that heavenly choir. There's a river I know, God who I'll cross over. River I've seen runs mighty rough and wild. There'll come a time the waves stop rolling. We're all gonna meet that day on the other side. Sometimes this world seems unforgiving. Troubled waters run deep and wide. Our time here is brief, and hope's eternal. Love is just as strong on the other side. There's a river I know, God who I'll cross over. River I've seen runs mighty rough and wild. And there'll come a time when the waves stop rolling. We're all gonna meet that day on the other side. We're all gonna meet that day on the other side. We're all.
The New Testament reading is taken from the Gospel according to John, chapter 6, verses 35 to 39. And Jesus said to the crowd before him, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet do not believe. Everything the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day." Word of God. Word of life. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
One of the many gifts Ray shared with us at MacNeill was his love of poetry, which went hand in hand with his love for the scriptures. He showed us that fully one-third of the Old Testament consists of poetry. And we should have realized that ourselves simply by looking at it on the page. But we know they don't look like prose, but because Hebrew rhymes and rhythms aren't detectable to us non-Hebrew readers, we just didn't notice all that poetry. Among the many Bible studies Ray taught over the years here at MacNeill was a series on the Psalms, which are all poetry intended to be sung. Ray loved metaphor, and the Psalms are full of original and powerful images. Earlier, we listened to Psalm 139, which contains the lines, "For it was you who formed me in my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb." This isn't science, but metaphor to describe the intimate relationship between the holy and the human. Ray loved not only ancient poetry, but more modern poetry as well. Poets like Margaret Avison, William Blake, Ursula Fanthorpe, and Malcolm Guite were Ray's companions. Especially during Advent and Lent, he encouraged us to make poetry part of our devotional lives. We live in a world where argument and debate and controversy dominate our lives, and it can be exhausting. In times of loss, especially, we hunger for something beyond the present concrete reality, something that can transcend. These are times when poems can speak to our souls, can take us out of ourselves, and we can fit the reading of poems into small moments in our busy days. I want to share with you a poem Ray wrote one year just after Christmas, and you may wonder why I would choose this poem about the journey of the Magi for a November afternoon. But I think it has something to say to us on a day when we gather to remember and honor a life precious to so many. It's about a journey far from the familiar, and perhaps it can sustain us as we move toward the end of a difficult year, a year when COVID has changed us all. Here is an invitation for us to transcend this time of losses, to offer our gifts, to find a new way forward. Ray calls the Magi prophets of Persia. Prophets of Persia, three kings, we say, whose employment was the foretelling, the rise and fall of kings, emperors, and tyrants. Followers of truth and light, who dare not tell a lie, lest the stars fall and the earth break. Chasing a star over wasteland, crossing deserts, driven by the need to know and the desire to acknowledge. Courteous to despots, and sometimes owned by them, but never, never trusting their ambitions nor their words. They brought gold through sand and wind, under sun, moon, and stars, over foot-scorching earth. Their royal presents were no more given to the imperial masters of their ancient world, whose dreams with their treasures were rusting and being savaged by the moth. They joined instead the echoes of choirs, the excited whispers of shepherds, the adoring murmurs of the dove animals at a birth, a strange, unusual birth. They chose another way and invite us to follow.
John, the gospel writer, and John of Patmos hand us these words of Jesus. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, though that one dies, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. The latter John had a vision of the experience of Jesus' followers beyond this life. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. And he guides them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. One long pandemic year since Ray's dying, we at last today have this blessed opportunity as an assembly to commend Trevor Raymond Hobbs into God's keeping. There have been and will continue to be multiple highly orchestrated pilgrimages involved in the part of the commendation that goes earth to earth. Ask the family. But there is a singular weaving together of our individual threads of appreciation for the man Ray into a cord that reaches from us to God in heaven, praying and rejoicing that just as Ray has borne the image of the earthly, so also by faith shall he bear the image of the heavenly. Let us pray. Our Lord, whether we live or die, we know that we are in your compassionate care. Here then, joined together to do so, we commit to your unfailing love, one whom we love. Thank you for Ray, for the bearing of his life upon ours, for the memories which live on with us. God, we rejoice in the privilege of having shared in his days. May those whom Ray leaves behind know the comfort, strength, courage, and guidance of your Holy Spirit now and in the days to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the memory of Trevor Raymond Hobbs, whom you have loved, linger long to bring you comfort, strength. And may the God of grace and providence, who raised from the dead Christ Jesus our Lord, grant you deep peace. Amen.
This morning will break, and your bad thoughts will fade as you rise and shake it off and get on with your day. You'll hear a sad song, it'll sound sweet, it'll turn your mood around as you follow your feet, and you'll notice